He's come a long way since the days of the Worcester Telegram. He is Ronald Kessler, a New York Times best-selling author of books about the Trump White House, Secret Service, FBI, CIA. This one about the White House is really big. The unvarnished and unbiased inside story of President Donald Trump and his White House by New York Times best-selling author Ronald Kessler. The book is called The Trump White House, Changing the Rules of the Game. Whether you're a fan of the president or not, you have to admit he has changed the rules of the game. Ron Kessler, it's an honor. Thanks for coming on.
Thank you very much.
So I'm looking through some of the headlines here. Author says Trump lies all the time, but still is a great president. It depends on who's reporting which quote they pick out. But would you stand by that quote?
Well, it was slightly exaggerated, but I certainly say in the book that he does regularly make up stories. It's pretty obvious. For example, the president of Mexico called me, et cetera. But it's all part of a strategy, and that is to get attention, even if it's bad.
Yeah.
And that creates more power. He's a person countries want to kowtow to, CEOs want to gravitate to, because he is the center of attention every single day.
Another issue is, you know, we remember hearing the story about how Donald Trump would call up as an anonymous, as his publicist and use a different name, and would leak stories out about this, that, and the other thing. In the book, do you say that he actually continues to do that a little bit?
Yeah, he will call, not exactly using a phony name, but he'll call certain reporters at the Washington Post and the Wall Street and the New York Times, and have his remarks attributed to a senior White House official. And, of course, he certainly has the right to do that, but on the other hand, it creates the impression that there are even more leaks in the White House than there are, and that sends a message to other aides, well, maybe we can do the same thing.
The fake news thing has really worked. It's funny, when you hear the president say something, and then you're, at McDonald's, and the old guy sitting there talking about Trump has picked up the president's catchphrase and is now using it like he's used it for 50 years. It's interesting.
Yeah. Well, you know, I have a whole chapter on press dishonesty. It's much more than bias, where they'll run a story with a shocking lead, such as the New York Times ran this model, Brewer had never met Trump when he asked her to change out of her clothes. And it turned out it was simply that she had been invited to a bathing suit party at the at Mar-a-Lago, and she didn't have time to go back and get a bathing suit at her home. Mm. He went there. He took a liking to her. He showed her around the estate, offered her a bikini, which she put on in the bathroom. And they started going out together. But guess where that was in the story? The 16th paragraph that they started dating. You know, unbelievable. You know, when I was at the Washington Post during Watergate, you did that and you were fired. There's no question about it.
Yeah.
By the way, what did you think of the movie, the Post, that was out?
Oh, I loved it. I was there during that time. You know, I brought tears to my eyes when the papers rolled off the presses. It was remarkably well done.
Is it? Do you think less of me to know that I wasn't there, was a young kid, but I watched that movie, and there were parts of that movie that I did tear up. I thought it was so inspirational in the way that how important what happened then was to our history. I had a tough time at times. Do you think less of me for that? I was
we're
emotional.
We're brothers.
That's right. I was living through you.
So can you talk us through maybe some of that time just a little bit? Describe that. I mean, like maybe some of the debates in the newsroom or some things you overheard.
Well, a lot of it was secret. It was in Ben Bradley's home. I remember that when the Supreme Court ruled in favor of the Washington Post and the Wall Street Journal, a top editor jumped up on top of a desk and said, we won, and New York Times won as well. It was so emotional and so incredible, because the Nixon White House was threatening the Washington Post day and night, and finally the right came out on top.
The Washington Post is still one of those. I mean, they are still big and still incredibly important. Do you feel they're do you read the Washington Post and say, "How this is so distorted, it's not fair," or are they still fair? What do you think? In regards to the president.
They have improved, and there are a lot of fair stories. Of course, the editorial side is totally against Trump, but that's fine. Yeah. That's opinion. But then other times they do run totally dishonest stories. And but one story was very important, and yet it's being ignored, and that was last August 14th in the Washington Post. There was a story that reported on emails that have been turned over by the White House to congressional committees, in which the top campaign people, the top Trump campaign people, were totally rejecting any efforts to deal with Russia. Papadopoulos, a minor Trump campaign aide, was trying to set up meetings with Russian leadership, and Manafort, the chairman of the campaign, said absolutely not. His deputy Gates said absolutely not. They said we have to make sure Trump doesn't do any of this. Manafort assigned another aide to make sure that nobody in the campaign responded to this. So what more do you need to know about the whole Russia collusion narrative than that?
We're talking to Ronald Kessler, New York Times best-selling author. He's the author of the book, The Trump White House, Changing the Rules of the Game. This is big. The leaks that are coming out, if they're not coming from the president, when they're not coming from the president, the leaks that aren't approved, who do you think the leaker is in the White House?
The number one leaker is Kellyanne Conway. Of course, she does a brilliant job on TV, but she seems to have this compulsion to leak and disparage colleagues. And when I was interviewing her at the White House and it was recorded, she apparently forgot that she was on the record, and she started disparaging Reince Priebus, saying the nastiest and most obviously untrue things about him, as well as against Jared and Ivanka as being leakers. And aides have told me that they have seen text messages that Kellyanne has sent to reporters in which she leaks as well. So if you want to know where most of the leaks are coming from, it's Kellyanne.
That is so interesting, because not only this is the point. She's really the only one left that's been there since the beginning, other than his children and his son-in-law. Really, part of the campaign staff. I mean, it's her and who else? Yeah.
This angle it was one of the headlines that came out when your book was first released. And I think Andrew and I both looked at each other and went,
It makes so perfect sense in the world.
How does he not know it is my question.
Ron, how does the president, is she doing the president's work? Or because there's reverse psychology and President Trump, it should be part of his middle name.
Yeah.
Because he's so good at it. So is she doing it without permission, with permission?
Without permission.
Oh.
It'll be interesting to see how he reacts to my book with this disclosure.
Because you've known the president for a long time and Melania as well.
Yeah. And one big point in the book is that Melania has a tremendous influence. She sits in on meetings, she summarizes what others say, then she comes up with her own strategy. And I quote Reince Priebus as saying that her judgment is really impeccable. It's so impressive.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, Trump likes to pull a mask over his face. He doesn't want any of this to come out. He wants to project this tough guy image. He doesn't want people to know that he hands out $100 bills, for example, to janitors for moving furniture. Doesn't want to say anything about Melania's role. And on every page in this book, I reveal new details about Trump and Melania and the White House that have not come out before.
Is he going to be angry with you for revealing this side of him?
I've heard that they're actually pleased with the book. It ends with the statement that he will be seen as one of the greatest presidents based on results. And years from now, all those tweets and controversies will be forgotten. The results are pretty obvious, both on the economy and both and on the foreign affairs side. And just like Reagan, who was reviled by the press, who then got rid of the Soviet Union and boosted the economy, I think the same thing will be true with Trump.
When they were going down the road of the president's mental health. And you've interviewed the president. You know the president. Did that bother you?
No. You know, I interviewed him at Mar-a-Lago a night before New Year's Eve. He was in perfectly good shape. You know, all you have to do is look at him on TV. These rumors were started by the Michael Wolff novel, as I call it. It's mainly fabricated information and just foolish, because anybody can see that it's not true by just looking at him on TV.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, if it's okay, I just want to ask one more question about Trump and Melania, because there's been a lot of reports and rumors out there that their marriage is rocky and that their relationship's awful and that they're on the verge of being totally separated.
That author had said that they don't sleep in the same bed, they don't, you know.
Yeah, no, not true. You know, obviously she's unsettled by the Stormy Daniels revelations, which, by the way, you know, took place over 10 years ago. I think he's gotten older and wiser since then, but she has risen above it. When I saw them at Mar-a-Lago, they were just having a ball together. They were, you know, they were in intense discussions. They were laughing and teasing. That's the relationship that they have. And so, again, if you see them together in a setting like that, you can tell this marriage is going to last.
And it's not like, you know, she just woke up today and said, who did I marry?
Yeah, right?
You know, and to the point you just made, there's been a couple stories about times when the president reached for her hand to hold her hand and she kind of pulled away and didn't. And I think it was right before the Easter weekend, they were leaving somewhere and they were like getting on a plane.
Yeah, yeah.
And she walked up and grabbed the president's hand. And I just, she is a lot more involved and I think smarter than people give her credit for.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
And Ron, we're almost out of time and it just burns me up because I could go on forever.
I know.
Man, you are a wealth of information. The key is, you can say it, but I'll say it for you, just buy my book.
Right.
Right, exactly.
There you go.
Buy the book. But one thing you do come away with this book is that you believe he will be remembered as one of the great presidents, that he has already accomplished so much and not been given credit for it.
Exactly. You know, the media will bury the story saying that black unemployment rate is at the lowest in recorded history, that ISIS is almost totally defeated. You know, people just put on blinders. They don't want to absorb that. But I think over time, you know, as the economy gets better and better, the stock market keeps zooming, people will start to recognize that, you know, this guy really is a great gift to the country.
Ron Kessler, the book is The Trump White House, Changing the Rules of the Game. If you've not been reading about it already, you will be, and you should be reading the book. Ron, thanks so much for coming on this morning.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.
Ronald Kessler, that was big, Andrew. A big score.
Wow, that was a fun interview. That was fun.
Big, big, big. And you know, I'm not a fan necessarily of this president, but I think fairness is so important, right?
Yeah.
Shouldn't we all be fair? Shouldn't you hope that the president who you don't like succeeds? Because if he does, so will the country. I'm not sure why we don't look at things that way.